My colleague Saurabh, who's actually, he and Robin are the guys who, along with Subit and his team in Mangaldai, they discovered this whole new thing. There's something called Made in India, there's something called Born in India. So I thought if I were Modi, I'd start a new thing called Born in India. And this Born in India, today I was coming and listening to the FM, and they talked about Khichdi festival. So in India we made Khichdi, so now Khichdi is being sold after yoga. So this is called Rural Futures, and Saurabh, the young generation seems to inspire much more. So let me bring Saurabh on board. I'm sorry, Saurabh, I forgot about it. Thank you.
Thank you, Ranjit, for the introduction. Karishma, can I have the presentation? I mean, actually, before I talk about Rural Futures, maybe we can just have a look at what happened last year at the EHNF and just quickly watch a video of EHNF 2016 before we actually move on to Eastern Himalayan Economics Forum 2017. So over the next 10 minutes, I'll just like to take you through the prototype of Rural Futures. And I'm going to do that by talking about some of the significant achievements of Palipara Foundation over the last 10 years, but more importantly, the challenges, the obstacles, and the learnings that we've had in the whole process, and how that's actually helped us to develop a socially inclusive model for conservation. So over the last 10 years, some of our most successful achievements have been the fact that we've launched a social enterprise called Wildmashare, which I think is the first and most successful example of the concept of nature-nomics. Wildmashare is not only a social enterprise, but it's also having a massive multiplier effect in the local economy of the whole Palipara area and beyond. Further to that, in the Eastern Himalayan Botanic Arc in Palipara, we've initiated the transformation of a barren parking lot into a forest, replete with biodiversity. This very simple experiment proves that nature really has the innate ability to heal itself, no matter what. Further, this conference that we're all here for actually began in the year 2013 by rewarding the real stalwarts of the environment and giving them the recognition that they deserve. Following that, we actually moved on to talking about elephants, and for 2 years we talked about elephants, and it was quite a big focus on a single but a very iconic species. Since last year, we've been talking about community conservation, and this year we're going to be talking about a more holistic approach to community conservation and the whole concept of rural futures. I think what's been really, really key over the last 10 years is that we've performed a lot of experiments in the field of conservation and in the field of social and community development. So some of the experiments that we performed from the last 10 years and the challenges that we faced through it because of either failures or successes have actually taught us that key to any large-scale conservation project really is community participation. That unless you have full community participation and community involvement, there cannot be any large-scale landscape conservation. Further to community conservation, what is really important is to try and generate employment through ecosystem-based services. This not only is essential to propagate the economy, but it's also a really good incentive to actually deploy the masses towards working for the environment and not against it. Another thing which is really, really important is inculcating stewardship behavior in the communities, because this is what allows these projects to go way beyond the actual time frame of the projects, because these projects normally last for about 3 years or 5 years, but we actually want them to go on forever. Following that, and I think what the overarching goal really is also, as Ranjit mentioned about the ethnobotany study and the preservation of botanic knowledge, is the whole idea of inculcating and propagating this botanic knowledge bank and the preservation of it throughout our efforts and throughout all the communities in the Eastern Himalayas. And the way we approached it is that Robin Eastman, who's here in the audience, and I lived in Udalguri for over 3 months, and we actually have become quite a part of the whole scene there. And what we really realized over talking to the villagers over a long, long time, actually becoming friends, going to their birthday parties and their weddings, is that the major problems you can only figure out if you live there. You know, so someone sitting in Bombay cannot design a conservation project which will work in Boroland or which will work in Arunachal. So I'm just going to take you through what I think Rural Futures really means, and then take you through a few steps that we've used to actually learn from the communities and design a project which we hope will be very, very successful. So Rural Futures is nothing but learning from the communities and actually using this knowledge to innovate and to create a concept for conservation which works for them, which is local and which is customized. So basically, I mean, over the course of talking to many people, what we actually figured out is that one of the largest problems in Boroland, in addition to the human elephant conflict bit, which I'll come to later, is water scarcity. So Boroland, the altitude of Boroland is much higher than that of Guwahati, and therefore groundwater levels are very, very low, so it's really tough to get water in Boroland. And the government is trying to build groundwater wells in Boroland. These wells work for a few years, but then they dry out. What a few of the villages actually do is dig up these dong-like canals and actually bring in water from the streams coming in from Bhutan, which is just 7 kilometers away from our site. So our next plan is to actually try and reinforce these streams, make sure that they're clean, put up a cover and actually a filter so people can continue using the whole dong-based system, which has been giving them water for centuries. So this really is a solution which will work only in that place, but I think that's the whole way in which we should really go about designing conservation projects for communities and for various other locations. So the next step to the whole inspiration phase, so we figured out that water is key.
Hetur karne manu he jontu niki risabor banailise pani dongodi ani ase hetu ek ma dui ma loke pani tu risabor kore hetu hodai মানে ব্যবহার করে থাকে ফিল্টার করে এটি নিজের ঘর এটি ব্যবহার করে নিজের গা চা ধুবলে কাপড় চাপড় ধুবলে ঠিক তেনে প্রবলেমসব ফেস করে আছে আর
অঞ্চলবাসী 10-12 গাঁও মিলি ননাই নদীর পরা সরু এটা ডং কাটি আনি বন বিভাগের লগত দরখাস্ত করে তেনেকে পারমিশন লৈ ডং কাটি আনি গাঁয়ে গাঁয়ে ঘরে ঘরে তেনেকা সরু সরু পুখুরী বনাই তাতে পানি আমি জমা করে খাও।
Yep, so basically the first person talking in the video is Amit Kujur who has been a great inspiration, and what he was trying to tell us through the video is that his family for centuries have been using water available from these dongs, and that water in these dongs hang around for at least 2-3 months during the winter dry spells. And it is at that point in time when the water gets really contaminated and scarce. So there has to be a way to store water in these dongs in the dry months. Following Amit was the headman of the village, again reiterating the fact that they have been using groundwater, and he really doesn't get why people are trying to find alternate solutions when there is a solution in the whole dong-based system. So what we've, the kind of idea that we have now is that at the center of our conservation project lies community-led habitat restoration, which is the star in the model. And because community-led habitat restoration is going to restore habitats, which I think is of extreme importance all over the Eastern Himalayas, irrespective of local issues, community-led habitat restoration can also lead to the generation of revenue in the long run through wild food, through timber, etc., etc. And this whole process of engaging with the communities and generating employment through habitat restoration allows us to develop social assets. And in this case, we've identified water as being of prime importance, but there are various other aspects of the rural futures verticals, which will come next in line. But water is key now because that is the need of the hour in Udalguri. The whole process of actually working with the communities leading to economic mobility through employment and leading to social mobility through the development of skills also allows them to come up with ideas for building sustainable businesses and using naturenomics to do business and to generate revenue for themselves. And this all, I believe, creates a positive feedback loop which could ideally feed back into creating more habitats and creating more forests. So our 10-year plan really for Rural Futures is that we begin with habitat restoration and generating employment through habitat restoration. Over the next 5 years, we identify what the key aspects are. And in this case, it is water, but for another place, it could very well be energy or waste management solutions. And over the next 10 years, try and create a model of successful usage of naturenomics, where we create a village environment living very, very close to a forest, in an area where there has been a lot of man-elephant conflict, but trying to solve this by improving the quality of the habitat, but also enhancing socio-economic mobility in the forest fringe communities to try and create a model where animals live in the forests, humans live alongside them as they have for centuries. Everybody's happy and everyone's got a bit of money to spend. So ultimately, I think all of us share a common goal is to have more trees in the world. So we want to restore habitats. We want to improve infrastructure in the village, which will lead to social mobility. And everybody wants revenue. I think the one thing which is really keeping rural India back is the possibility of generating revenue. But if we count on our natural assets and actually make the most of the natural assets that we have, I think generating revenue will be way easier than in the urban areas. And all of this kind of leads to a very multifaceted community development, which also leads to the ultimate preservation of our biocultural heritage, which we here, I think, are really, really blessed with. And I think the ultimate overarching goal is not only human wellness, but also animal wellness alongside it. We will talk about this more over lunch, and I think all the programs that will follow through this day will touch on various verticals of rural futures, which we think are integral to creating a model village, which would be an example in the future for rural Eastern Himalayas to follow and to replicate. Thank you.